There's really nothing more frustrating than having finally the time to write and you just are too tired to think and write. Welcome to my dungeon! So, how to write when you are exhausted? Those of you who've been around know that I had a baby recently, so I have not slept through the night for quite some time now. And that does not make for having the best writing ability or motivation. Yet, as for most of the writers, not writing is even worse than trying to when you're tired. So it makes me feel empty and depressed. It makes me feel forlorn. So here are some tips how to keep writing when you are exhausted, based on what worked for me and some thoughts from people in my writing group. Number one, small, manageable goals. When you're exhausted, you can't write as much as you do on regular days. Definitely not as you do on your best days. Accept it and treat all and any words as a success. One of my writer friends has a rule of writing 3 paragraphs per day. Each day or each time you have a little bit of time to write. It's small enough goal, but not to be overwhelming, but long enough to possibly lead to longer writing, that you get into the story and you just keep writing because you started going with those 3 paragraphs and now you wrote over the writing block. It may seem counterintuitive, but setting lower goals may let you write more, as it's easy to get discouraged when you're tired, when you can't reach your normal goals. And then you're likely, or at least more likely, to quit writing altogether or until you feel better. Okay, number two, work on a different project. Sometimes switching to a different project is all what's needed for my creativity to start flowing again. Usually it's a new one, but as frustrated as I am with my ever-growing works in progress list, there are started books that will be easier to finish once I get over being tired. I will have a couple thousands of words written in them, and then I will be able to decide if I want to finish them or not. But either way, it's one less story rattling around in my brain. So, in the worst case scenario, I'm at least relieved of the kind of emotional weight of having this story that I kind of thought about and I wanted to write. So, at least starting it kind of makes it easier for me to forget if I don't want to continue. So, write any project, maybe already one that you already started, or maybe start another one. Any writing is all in. Number three, write short stories. If you've been writing your novel for a while, most likely your plot and characters are getting quite complex and you have multiple subplots going on. And that can be overwhelming jumping in and hard to stay on top when you're exhausted. Short stories are way easier and faster to write. And you can quickly get a dopamine hit from finishing something. Though most new writers I met and talked to struggle with writing short stories, mostly because they are mostly reading novels. So that's their default for telling a story. So, if you're curious about writing and reading short stories, but are unsure where to find good ones, let me shamelessly plug, for research purposes of course, our anthology Holding Out for a Healer. It's a collection of clean short stories that would be rated PG-13 if they were movies, with a male healer as the main character. Unfortunately, I'm still to make the official review because it is for some reason still not published as a paperback on Canadian Amazon. You can order it in States, so and you can order ebook in Canada, but we didn't publish it straight through Amazon because Amazon doesn't really do revenue splitting. So I guess Amazon doesn't like us anymore. So I'm still waiting for being able to have a paperback because it's very important to me to have a paperback to wave around when going through the review. But going back to writing the short stories, I think the easiest way is to grab your characters from your current work in progress and have them do something not as important as your whole plot, but like hunting down a single monster or having a Christmas celebration. Actually, our writing group has each Christmas like an inside anthology, I guess, that we write Christmas stories for each other and we just read them on the Christmas day. So that has been my favorite Christmas tradition. So I recommend it starting with your writing group if you have one. Okay, on to number four, switch genders. How do you pronounce genders? Sorry, I have no idea. I almost exclusively write and read fantasy, but when I'm really tired, I started to like reading fluffy contemporary romances because that's something I cannot take seriously. So writing a romance was easier because it had less pressure for me. Because I accepted the silliness, the low stakes, and a simple plot as the expectation. If I ever publish it, since my main publishing focus is also on fantasy stories, a single contemporary romance that's not even an urban fantasy, it's not going to significantly impact my writing career. The most I could hope for is a handful of random sales, even after I have multiple books out, which I don't at the moment. And normally that would mean that there's really no point for me in writing it, but when I'm not able to write my serious stories, like the stories I do want to write and include in this like main vision of what I want to write, working on a project that I don't really have high hopes or expectations of, and I don't really care if it's published or not, it's quite freeing. Maybe fantasy will be your escape from your serious thriller writing, or even from contemporary romance, if that's what you usually write. Number five. So maybe you want to stick with your main project, and that's the only reason you are watching this video at all, because you have to finally make progress on your one serious project. Or maybe you're just too tired to think of another one to start. The answer in this situation could be the candy bar scenes. Those are the scenes you've been really waiting to write. Well, wait no longer. Many would argue that you should make every scene a candy bar scene, and they'd be right. But now it's not the time to worry about that. It is time to write. Okay, let's get moving to number six. Bad words are still words. When you're tired, you're not likely to do your best writing. But bad words are still words. You can edit bad words, and as much as I hate editing, it is better than not having words at all. And definitely better than not having bad words and complaining about it. Beyond that, bad words are still progress. They are also practice. Practice in writing, practice in consistency, and practice in keeping negative thoughts away. I don't know about you, but if I'm not writing for an extended amount of time, I start talking myself into that I'm never going to be a writer, that I'm never going to finish things. So it's very important for me to keep the mental space happy by proving to myself that I am doing what I can. Number seven, when you cannot even write bad words, then read, watch, play video games, absorb stories and recharge. It is part of the process for many writers and often necessary to be able to keep writing. When you already have limited time to write, it may seem wrong or self-indulgent, but you can't pour from empty. So if that's enough to convince you, there may be some more problems. I do have a problem deciding on what I want to read. It helps to stick with an author that I trust, so I know what to expect. And it's easier to decide if I'm in the right mood for their writing. Sometimes I'm in such specific mood that I can only choose one of my favorite books or movies to reread or rewatch. Sometimes I really want to read something new that I never read before. So then I'm choosing one of the freebies I got through the year from a freebie newsletter because I may like it, I may not, but at least I didn't spend money on it. One of my writers likes to watch something cheesy like a rom-com or a B-monster movie, and she says that they are almost the same, and I understand her reasoning, but I don't agree. But since you are not likely to take either of them seriously, they may just be the thing that gets you going. Number 8, switching to a different art form can be really freeing and relaxing, and it can lead you back into creativity. I keep daydreaming about painting, but with all the smaller kids running around who would want to join in for sure, that there will be very little chance of that being relaxing. But for you, it may be one of the options. You can try drawing, digital art, crochet or knitting, embroidery, sewing, jewelry making, sculpting, or anything else that comes to mind. Even adapting novel to a script, as I did over the summer, while still technically rewriting, it uses different parts of the brain and was easier then. And it got me to write my things again. Number 9 is taking a break. If you've been pushing yourself for quite a while, or you are going through significant life change, chances are that even all the tips together or trying by one will not be enough to get you back to writing. You may be at the point when you're too tired to do anything. If that's the case, let me give you a permission for a guilt-free break. Survive to write another day. Number 10 is kind of similar, but a little bit more. Take care of yourself. Speaking of survival, go drink water. Probably you didn't yet, hey? Eat fruits, vegetables, look into supplements. It would be silly if all your writing problems would be caused by dehydration or malnutrition. So if that's that, try to fix it and see if it works. And if it won't, you still will be benefiting from that. All the best and see you next week.